Section 1 of The Wing of Azrael, Volume 3. The Wing of Azrael, Volume 3, by Mona Caird. Chapter 29. A Dangerous Acquaintance. When Viola regained consciousness, she was lying on her bed. Mrs. Barber, with a portentous array of eau de cologne and sal volatile bottles, stood over her, looking unutterable woe. She fell to rubbing Viola's hands, and to applying vast quantities of eau de cologne to her forehead.
"Well, I am glad to see you restored, ma'am. I thought you was dead and gone, that I did. Permit me to apply some more eau de cologne, just above the temples."
"Thank you, Mrs. Barber. Not any more at present," said Viola, who was already sopping just above the temples, in consequence of the housekeeper's amiable enthusiasm. "If I might have a dry handkerchief. The eau de cologne is running into my eyes."
"I expect the walk was too long for you," Mrs. Barber continued. "On a hot day like this, too. I never did think those long walks was quite conducive,"
the word as she understood it being entirely self-contained. Viola longed to lie back and rest and be silent, but Mrs. Barber talked on, till at last Philip and Geoffrey came up, and the housekeeper retired, in answer to a nod from Philip.
"All right now, Viola?" asked her brother.
"Yes, I am better," she said.
"Who do you think has been calling?"
"Harry Lancaster. But we thought it well not to let you come down to see him. He was sorry to hear of your not being quite up to the mark."
"Oh." She seemed but little moved.
"And he was very sorry to miss seeing you, and other things polite. I don't think he looks well. Are you going to get up again today?"
"Yes, I am all right now."
Viola dreaded that, as soon as Geoffrey left, Philip would speak to her about her meeting with Harry. The house seemed to stifle her. She hurried out and away across the gardens to the cliffside pathway leading to the beach. The sea was just growing calm with the sinking of the wind, and gleaming with the mellow tints of afternoon. There was a whisper of spring in the air. Little white clouds overhead were carrying the sweet message from land to land. In a few minutes, Viola was on the lonely shore, the waters sweeping to her feet. She lay against a long, wave-like ridge of pebbles which the tides had flung up to stem their own advance upon the land. At times of strong excitement, human feeling is not simple, but infinitely complex. Nothing is too trivial to consider, nothing is too alien to the central emotion. Viola lay watching the overlapping curves of the little waves which raced one another to the strand, watching the fretwork of foam spreading between ridge and ridge, and the brilliant reds and browns which the touch of water revealed in the so-seeming virtuous pebbles, like the unsuspected things which tears will summon forth in human hearts. Wave after wave for 10,000 years has furrowed the brown sand here. Wave after wave, under clouds and stars, has cried in the dead shore's ear. Thus for centuries the sea had beaten, just as today on the crumbling coast, and probably for centuries after would beat so, while the joy and anguish of human souls came and passed away as the shadow of a cloud over the sea, or as a tremor in some salt pool left by the resilient waves. When the human being fully realizes how utterly he is swallowed up and lost in the world of infinities, the moment is always vital and terrible, though it has been felt and described so many times before. The realization seldom comes until, seeking in vain for help, the sufferer finds himself shouting to a deaf universe, and hears his own voice dismally echoing through its unending spaces. Viola, who had hitherto been shielded by religious teaching from this conception, felt the horror of it come upon her today overpoweringly. There was pain, look which way she would, pain in her own little world of being, exquisite, unbearable, pain in the thought of the vast, soulless, indifferent universe, a giant machine grinding on forever, without haste and without rest. Where were the previous morning's faith and peace? All gone, and in their place, doubt, hatred, disgust, wounded dignity, wounded affection, devouring anxiety, and overall a consciousness that this hot emotion mattered nothing and availed nothing, that presently the waves would be beating and retreating, with only the cliff and the gulls for audience. Religion spoke warningly, but the familiar voice was not heeded. Viola turned her face to the hard stones and broke into deep, silent, terrible sobbing. Some heartstring seemed to break with each sob. So still had she lain there that the seagulls, cold-hearted birds, came sweeping quite close to her and over her head. At length, the crisis of the passion came. The wave broke and passed on. There was one tight, stifled cry, and then Viola, changing her attitude, fell into a sort of lethargy. She was dimly conscious of the stirring wind and the unresting sea sound, dimly conscious of the golden glow that began to light up the sky. The waves sounded hoarse and desperate. Deeper and deeper grew the blood-red stain upon the waters, and the land seemed to have caught fire. The swiftest cloud streaks were overtaken, and their cool white turned into gold. At the wet wave line upon the sands, a figure, clad in sunset red, was slowly strolling, stooping now and again with swift movement to snatch some feathery seaweed from the tide. A large brown dog accompanied her, barking when she flung a pebble for him into the sea, that he might swim out in pretended search, to return and shake himself, and bound and bark again for another mimic errand. The two figures worked their way gradually along the shore. Viola, lying against the ridge of pebbles, presently opened her eyes and found the dog standing beside her, dripping from tail and legs and ears, and threatening at any moment to shake himself with vigor. But a voice recalled him. Viola started up. She felt as if she ought to rise and flee from it. It was the voice of a siren, luring from the ways of righteousness. She felt that instantly. Sibella, turning to pick up a stone for her tyrannical dog, found herself face to face with Viola. Both women colored deeply, and for a moment there was silence.
"I beg your pardon for unknowingly disturbing you. I thought myself alone."
Sibella hesitated, colored again, and then said, almost shyly,
"I have been very anxious for this meeting, Mrs. Dendraith. You observe, this is not the first time I have seen you."
Viola, too excited and bewildered to know what she thought or felt, continued to gaze at her companion in silence. Perhaps Sibella saw or divined her feelings, for she sat quietly down on the shingle by her side and began to talk. She spoke without personal reference, but with a subtle implication of comradeship which touched Viola's loneliness, as the glow of the fireside is welcome to one shivering and belated. Then, more fancifully, she spoke of the sea, of its perpetual variety, its endless range of expression and meaning. She went on to speak about the down country inland, contrasting it with the tame fields and pastures among which she had spent her childhood and her married life. Viola grew interested, and the more Sibella told her, the more breathlessly interested she became. There was a strange resemblance to her own experience in the story that Sibella told. She, too, had been strictly and watchfully brought up. She, too, had begun life with a store of principles. Enough, Sibella said, to stock the bench of bishops. Before half an hour had passed, Viola was speaking as she had never before spoken to human being. Her cheeks were flushed, her eyes burnt with excitement. The unwonted utterance had thrown a confused light upon her own emotions, while the comments of her companion, flinging brilliant cross-flashes, frightened and allured at the same time.
"But what do you mean? I don't understand. It turns things topsy-turvy," Viola cried with a sort of terror-stricken excitement.
She stretched out her arm as if trying to grasp again the bulwarks of her creed. A firm, gentle hand was laid in hers.
"Don't be frightened to open your eyes and to use your reason. If the creeds of our youth are true, they can bear the light. We have both been taught, as we imagined, to worship God. I fear that we have really been taught to worship the devil. We were trained to submission, to accept things as they are, to serve God by resignation. Yes, even the resignation of our human dignity. Whereat the devil laughs in his sleeve and carries off the fruits of miserable lives to add to the riches of his kingdom. Oh, I can never believe so, cried Viola. No, we are both well grounded, said Sibella. But you are naturally more conscientious than I. The better the soil, the richer the harvest for the devil. I always questioned and doubted, though from force of circumstances I obeyed. But there came a crisis in my life, and then I broke away. I don't say it is a success, but in refusing to submit to what was degrading, I have at least rescued myself from the unbearable self-loathing which a woman... The speaker paused, as Viola drew in her breath sharply. Sibella laid her hand upon her arm. It is better to face things, she said gently. You have not suffered quite alone. I told you in what circumstances my marriage took place. A mere child, brought up without knowledge of life, of my fellow creatures, of the very laws and customs which were to rule my destiny. Everything in my surroundings was untrue, unscientific, groundless, fabricated. In my cramped, painful little world, there were 1,000 invented crimes, 1,000 invented tortures, and in the close, motionless atmosphere, these things grew more monstrous and unwholesome every day. This process of education and subsequent marriage, through which so many sensitive girls are made to go, always reminds me of the torture that the Romans inflicted upon one of their generals who had offended them. They cut off his eyelids, and then compelled him to sit in the blazing sun. I, having been worked up through years of training to a state of overwrought sensitiveness, was asked to give my hand in marriage to a man whom I scarcely knew, and for whom I cared nothing, a man who regarded women as his lawful prey, let them fill what position in life they might. The family was eager for an heir, to provide one, and afterwards to devote to him my whole life and energies, was to be my sacred duty and privilege. Viola gave a slight movement, and Sibella tightened the grasp of her hand. I, of course, did not understand all this. How could I? My pastors and masters had exhausted the dictionary for terms to express the blessedness and the poetry of what they called a woman's destiny. How was I, a bewildered girl knowing nothing of the world, trusting that my parents had my welfare at heart, how was I to know that legalized insults and indignities were in store for me? You must think wrongly of it, Viola broke out. It is God-ordained. Don't take that belief from me, or I shall go mad. My poor girl, you have already lost that belief. I am not taking it from you. Viola turned away, not denying. After a moment of silence, she said, Please go on. This has a terrible interest for me. My parents must have known that the marriage was unsuitable, but they had brought up their daughter with the strictest and most admirable principles, and they trusted to that to keep things straight and the family honor, as they humorously called it, intact. As a rule, the method answers. Society is founded upon the success of such exploiting, but in my case it failed. I ought not to listen, Viola murmured. You ought to listen and then to judge, said Sibella. The story is so painfully obvious, and yet nobody sees it or admits it. And so the hoary old hypocrisies are kept up, that threadbare cant which yet holds bravely together and is thick enough still to hide the truth from our crops of fresh young victims as they spring up year after year. Viola pushed back the hair from her brow in a sort of desperation. Most women, Sibella pursued, spend their energies in making all these time-honored iniquities possible and successful, encouraging the repetition of these profitable old crimes, apparently for all eternity. The fortitude and goodness of the victims are relied upon, and not in vain, to ward off from their perpetrators the natural punishment. It is for the victims to pay the price of the iniquity and to make it socially successful,
and this they must do and keep silence on pain of excommunication. If the fortitude breaks down, ah, then what a hue and cry. The woman is hunted, scorned, ruined. There is no mercy. Sibella turned suddenly to her companion. Are you going to make successful another of these old villainies? Are all women who come after you to be worse off, to be heavier-hearted because of you? Viola half rose, as if to leave her dangerous companion. But she did not go. If you are right, Mrs. Lincoln, the best and noblest women I have known are all wrong. Their goodness and their suffering has been in vain. And so are the virtues and the martyrdoms of good women in vain. That is why the devil finds our planet such a happy hunting ground. I assure you he enjoys himself immensely. He is full of humor. What's that? There was a sound of footsteps over the shingle. She raised herself to look over the pebble ridge. Is anyone coming? Asked Sibella. Viola had turned white. My husband, she said. Oh, Sibella's expression changed. He will be angry at finding us together. I understand. It was my fault, if fault there be. Remain passive. Say as little as you can, and keep as much as possible your usual manner. Philip raised his eyebrows slightly on seeing his wife's companion. Mrs. Lincoln, what fortunate star directed my steps towards this spot? Then you are glad to see me here, Sibella observed, looking up into his face with a singular smile. Do you throw a doubt upon my good taste? He inquired. I cannot be guilty of that mistake since meeting your wife. I bow for us both, returned Philip. I never can get my wife to bow for herself. She has an admirable model always before her eyes. I am lost in admiration of your bows. I wish you had lived in the last century. Thanks, said Philip. Your compliment is intoxicating. You would have been perfect in a minuet, Mr. Dendraith. We have none of that delightful dignity of movement in these days. Stateliness and grace have died out. Pardon me. Oh, this is too much, laughed Sibella. My worst enemies have never yet called me stately. Graceful? She pursed up her lips and raised her eyebrows. Perhaps. I have studied that a little. But stately, I should die in the attempt. You do not leave a bewildered creature time to catalogue your attributes, Mrs. Lincoln. He can only think of you as a delightful and dazzling whole. I am glad you don't think me unfinished, said Sibella, dismissing the subject. How glad I am to have made Mrs. Dendraith's acquaintance. One never really knows a man till one knows his wife. Mrs. Dendraith throws, unconsciously, a flood of light on your character. Most becoming, she added. Philip's lips looked rather tight about the corners, but he smiled and said suavely, It is very kind of you to take my wife in hand, Mrs. Lincoln. To know you is a liberal education. You overwhelm me. If you stay much longer in this position, I fear the sea will do that, Philip returned. Viola, my love, do you contemplate restoring the grace of your presence to my humble abode before nightfall?
I am ready to come now.
Then my house will be a home once more, he said, drawing Viola away to the side farther from Sibella. Mrs. Lincoln, you will permit me to walk back with you.
Thank you, no, I do not require an escort.
Once more, then, let me express my deep gratitude for having interested yourself so kindly in my wife. He looked Sibella full in the face as he said this, holding out his hand. Laying hers in it, she returned the look point blank, and replied with a little smile and bend of the head, Please don't thank me. I feel myself so unworthy. Though I am interested in all that concerns you, my interest in Mrs. Dendraith has arisen quite independently of any such sentiment, and thanks weigh heavy on my soul as ill-gotten treasure. Once more, goodbye. She turned with a significant bow and smile, called her dog, and walked quietly away. A challenge had been tacitly given and accepted.
Was this prearranged? Philip asked.
No, accidental.
"Perhaps you had other fish to fry," he suggested. She did not answer. "I need not observe that our fascinating friend is not fit society for you, my dear." Although this had been Viola's own opinion until this afternoon, she flushed painfully. "You must intimate, politely but firmly, that you feel obliged to forego the pleasure of her further acquaintance. Better avoid the shore in the afternoon, as she seems inclined to make it a promenade."
"What is she accused of?" asked Viola.
"A mere friskiness," returned Philip, "culminating in a trifling elopement, scarcely worth mentioning. Lancaster's bosom friend, Elliot, was the happy man."
"Did she leave her husband to go with this man?"
"Well, no, she went away alone, but it is supposed that he followed her afterwards. Anyhow, she did not break with him, as a prudent woman would have done in her slippery position. There was no divorce, of course, but her character is gone. No woman can associate with her and keep her own in good feather. I wonder a young person of respectable instincts like you would be seen speaking to her. It must not happen again."
"What has become of the man?"
"Elliot, that is a delicate question, my dear. What does happen to men who run after other men's wives? Scripture is mute upon the subject. Elliot is now expiating his misdeeds in another, but, alas, I dare not affirm with confidence, a better world. Perchance he is doomed to a cycle of never-ending flirtation with his neighbor's wives, till he wishes he had never been born."
"He is dead," said Viola.
"You are a trifle bold, my love, in your expression. Say rather he has departed. He has gone to another sphere. He is at rest. Of course, the lass is rather euphonious than instructive."
"Has anyone a right to condemn Mrs. Lincoln when her sin is only conjectured?" asked Viola. Philip shrugged his shoulders.
"Possibly not. I merely explain to you that to associate with her is to take the bloom off of your own reputation, and I have no notion of possessing a wife in that bloomless condition. Now I hope I have explained myself clearly, my dear. Not a breath, not a whisper shall go forth against the woman to whom I have given my name. Take care that you do nothing to give rise to it. You will see nobody, man or woman, without my knowledge. You will make no acquaintance, man or woman, without my knowledge. You will receive no letter that is unseen by me. And now," Philip held open the gate into the garden gallantly, "now to the home of which you are the sunbeam." End of section 1.
Section 2 of The Wing of Azrael, Volume 3. The Wing of Azrael, Volume 3 by Mona Caird. Chapter 30. A Tough Battle. Sibella sat in a low chair before the fire, with a blotting pad and writing materials on her knee. She had abandoned her ruddy-tinted gown, and wore a fashionably made dress of dark cloth, neatly braided. Mrs. Russell Courtney herself would not have felt unhappy in the attire. Several sheets of writing paper lay on the table, each with the commencement of a letter abruptly abandoned. Sibella was now struggling with another letter, writing a few words between long intervals of gazing into the fire. She wrote to the end of the first page, and then, with an impatient movement, tore off the half-sheet, crumpled it in her hand, and threw it into the flames. The next few minutes were spent in sketching fabulous creatures on the edge of the blotting-pad, and writing under them the names of common domestic animals. Sibella appeared to devote herself heart and soul to this occupation, looking at her sketch from this side and from that, adding brightness to the eye and spirit to the tail, by means of deeply considered touches. The being under which she traced the letters D-O-G had a strange, square-looking jaw and an appalling grin. His tail, when unfurled, must have been available as a weapon at a distance of several yards, and along his backbone the hair stood up in a ridge, indicating a spirit sorely aggrieved. Facing this work of art was a creature of the panther order, thin and strong and agile, with a watchful eye and a look of stealthy swiftness. Under this image the artist wrote, somewhat inconsequently, "Philip Dendraith." "Dear Miss Dendraith,
It will surprise, and I fear displease you, to receive. Dear Mrs. Dendraith, please believe I am actuated by a friendly spirit. Dear Mrs. Dendraith, could you meet me tomorrow afternoon on the shore at 3 o'clock? I want very much to— Sabella pushed away the paper in despair, and supporting her chin on her hands, sat looking steadily into the fire. The doorbell rang. Ah, if it were only that poor girl! Sabella gathered together her papers and awaited the announcement of her visitor. A maid brought in a card. The lady wished to know if you could see her, mum. The shadow of a train of thought seemed to pass through Sabella's eyes in the second of silence that followed. I shall be glad to see Miss Lancaster. Adrienne, looking rather pale but very composed, was ushered into the room. Sabella had risen and bowed. I have to apologize for this intrusion, began Adrienne. Please don't apologize. Will you take a chair near the fire? Thank you, I prefer to avoid it. The wind is sharp outside. Adrienne sat down, wondering if there were anything in her manner to show that her heart was beating so hard that she could scarcely draw her breath. I think it well to plunge into my business at once, she said, when Sabella had drawn her chair facing her visitor, and placed herself in a calm attitude of attention. Please do so. I came on behalf of my friend, Mrs. Dendraith. She has sent you? Not exactly. Yesterday afternoon I called at her house, and found that she had just returned from a long interview with you on the beach. Mrs. Dendraith told me all that you had said to her. Adrienne looked her hostess full in the face, as if she expected her to flinch from her righteous gaze. She told you all I said to her, Sabella repeated with the gleam of a smile in her eyes. And what did you think of it? Adrienne flushed with indignation. Since you ask me, Mrs. Lincoln, I must confess that I think it is the most extraordinary, the most unprincipled advice that I have ever heard in my life. I listen to Mrs. Dendraith in incredulous amazement. I know that you have long been my brother's friend, and therefore I have hitherto felt ready to believe well of you. Sabella gave a little bow. But when I hear that you not only hold such views yourself, but actually try to poison with them the innocent mind of a young wife, then I feel that the innocent mind calls for your protection. I admire your championship and self-sacrifice. I fear this interview must be painful for you. I should have imagined that you might have felt it painful, said Adrienne with a gasp. Oh, no, returned Sabella politely, not at all. The visitor was silent for a moment, collecting her energies. I come here today to make an appeal to you, to rouse your sense of justice and mercy, to represent to you what a terrible injury you may do to that young wife. She is not happy, as a person of your penetration would quickly see, but she is supported by high principle. She is noble, she is self-sacrificing, she is pure. Faith is her sheet anchor, and I consider that anyone who robs her of it, or shakes it by so much as a passing doubt, is guilty of a cruel, an accursed deed. Adrienne paused, breathless with disgust and anger. Mrs. Lincoln's steady look was full of judicial attention. Her expression was almost sympathetic. I have believed, Adrienne went on, curbing her indignation, I have always believed that no human being is wholly devoid of good. Not even such as I, Miss Lancaster. Not if you will give the better impulses fair play, Adrienne returned severely, at which the others smiled. Oh, Mrs. Lincoln, if you had seen that poor girl yesterday as I saw her, you would not smile. It was terrible. She came to me entreating and imploring that I would make her believe again, that I would reconvince her of her own principles and of the love of God. Everything seemed to have gone from her, and it is you, Mrs. Lincoln, whom she has to thank for this. I wish you had seen her fling herself upon the sofa, crying that she could not endure to live, that she was lowered and humiliated forever, that it was intolerable to be herself. Of course it is a very morbid idea, but I cannot get it out of her head. Ah, Sabella said, to feel so is to endure the tortures of the damned. "Are you quite heartless?" Adrienne said, bringing down her little clenched hand upon her knee. "Have you no pity, no forbearance? If you must have disciples, if you can't rest satisfied with flinging over every law of God and man on your own account, why, in the name of reason, must you pick out for your followers sensitive creatures who suffer in this dreadful way? You care for this girl very sincerely, I think."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.